The following program is a Town of Colonie television production of the William K. Sanford Town Library.
Welcome to Albany County News. I'm Mary Rozak, the Director of Communications for Albany County. And today we are going to talk about our Department for Children, Youth, and Families and some programs, the upcoming month of April, which is Child Abuse Prevention Month, and something that's been in the news a lot lately, and that's human trafficking. So joining me is the Commissioner of DCYF, Gail Geohagen-Pratt. Welcome back.
Thanks, Mary.
So, you know, before long, I mean, April, I can't believe how quickly the year has gone so far, and we have been talking about things that are going to be going on in April. Every
Absolutely.
April we highlight Child Abuse Prevention Month mm-hmm. because a lot of it is, it's really about awareness.
Absolutely. And so it certainly speaks to an integral part of the Department for Children, Youth, and Families. We have our Child Protective Investigative Services within the Children's Services Division of our department. And so really wanting to, at the core of it, how do we protect children? How do we address safety? And so with April being Child Abuse Prevention Awareness Month, it really gives an opportunity for us to have more of an external voice, if you will, and really being able to have more community awareness and outreach in regards to how we can all collectively, because I really view this as not a CPS issue, but really a community issue, mm-hmm. in regards to how do we all collectively as a community protect our children. And so in regards to being able to also educate children, because, you know, they are also empowered and can advocate for themselves as well. You know, we still need the adults, but, you know, really being able to empower them with information. And so as part of the Child Abuse Awareness Month activities, we have a poster contest. And so we reach out to all the school districts within Albany County and really advocate for their participation in terms of having the youth submit posters. And each year we have a theme. So this year's theme is I Am the Future. Again, it's really about empowering young people to know that they have value and they have a voice, and that what they think and what they have to say is important. And so when you think about what your future looks like, really wanting them to be able to see that in pictures. So yes.
And I love going, because we get to judge, we see all of them. I think last year it was huge. There were so
yes.
many submissions last year.
There absolutely were. We had well over 75 submissions. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, we're grateful because this is based on the participations of the local school districts being willing to do so. We certainly understand that, you know, there are curriculums and there are agendas set. So the fact that they are willing to collaborate with us and to bring this in and to have the students participate, we certainly appreciate that. So we're looking forward to the participation again this year, and we're looking forward to the submissions. As you say, when we get them in, you know, we open it up to all the county employees to be able to come in and see the posters and to be able to judge. And it's such a tough thing because there are so many posters, and, you know, the creativity and mm-hmm. just the artistic expression of each of those students, it's just blows the mind. And so
and
I look
and there are
forward.
Different, there are different age and grade,
there
grade level
different,
groups that we judge, yeah.
Absolutely. So, you know, from the elementary school level all the way up to high school, we get a variety. And so it's just, and it doesn't matter how young or old, the creativity is just astounding on all levels. So looking forward to that. And then I think we've gotten a lot of positive feedback, because what we'll do for the month of April is to have all the previous submissions hung up in the lobby. So mm-hmm. as people come into the building, they're able to view the past posters that were submitted. And we always get a very positive response when folks walk into the lobby and they see that. It just helps to brighten the lobby, I think, and then also have a personalized aspect to it, just seeing the drawings of the students and the young people. So
it's very nice. And I know that it seems for the past couple of years that the theme has been the same. I think it was what a family means to me.
So in previous years, we've had what a family means to me. And so just, you know, again, to change it up a little bit and, you know, so that when the students are being asked to participate, that it gives them something else to think about.
Sure.
And so, you know, and I think that's something that, you know, no matter what age you are, you start to think about, what does my future, what do I want to be? And so I think this will spark some really good creative submissions. So we're looking forward to that.
So there are some people out there who may ask, you know, it's wonderful that there's the poster contest, but how does it actually tie in to awareness for Child Abuse Prevention Month?
Because then it actually stirs conversation. And so, you know, part of when we do the outreach to the schools, we provide information in regards to really what the purpose is and why we're reaching out and asking for students to participate in it. So we provide a framework in terms of just some of the words and the language that can be used in introducing the subject and soliciting the posters from the children as to why we do that. And then, as you mentioned, when we have once the judging takes place and there are the winners that are identified, then we go out to the schools, and within the schools we reinforce the messaging in regards to, you know, safety of youth and families and really strengths of families and really the empowerment of youth and how they have a voice in terms of their own future and their safety and their well-being. And so really being able to engage them in conversation, and you know, that is definitely one of the highlights of what I do, is being able to have those opportunities to go out and have those conversations with youth. And it is amazing their minds and what it is that they have to say, and really how aware they are in terms of their own well-being and presence and value. So that's always nice.
It's nice to do the posters. There's also something that's very visual that you do with pinwheels for prevention. Talk about that.
Yes. So in conjunction, a collaboration with Prevent Child Abuse America, the pinwheels is their symbol in regards to child abuse prevention. And so if for the last 3 or 4 years now, we've been able to partner with them and have pinwheels that we put in the median on State Street. So you can imagine in April, it's just a little nippy out there. And we usually actually end up having a little bit of wind. Mm-hmm. And so we have the pinwheels planted, if you will, as a garden of pinwheels, and they're blue and silver or purple and silver. And so it really is quite the visual as people are walking and driving along. And we usually will have a sign up as to, you know, so people are aware as to why the pinwheels are there. And it usually generates a lot of positive feedback. And just, again, the visuals is just kind of stunning.
Let's talk about those are great things to bring awareness. And, you know, child abuse is one of those issues where people are incredibly uncomfortable. They may suspect something, a neighbor may suspect something. I know there are certain reporting requirements if you're a teacher or a doctor, et cetera. But if you're a neighbor or you're a friend and you're not quite sure, so you hesitate, what is a recommendation or a guideline for someone who may suspect something, but they're thinking, I'm not really sure and I don't really want to get involved?
Well, it's interesting because I think similar to the slogan that has been you know, sort of broadcasted throughout our nation in response to terrorism, if you see something, say something. I would say it's along those lines as well. We're not looking for someone to know for certain that something is happening, but certainly if you have a reasonable suspicion to suspect, that's really the basis of it, then would really advocate that you say something, whether or not you know someone who is a mandated reporter and so you bring that information to them, or if you call the State Central Registry. That's why we have the State Central Registry. They take the information and they determine whether or not it meets that standard in terms of some credible evidence of suspicion to suspect child abuse, and they're the ones that really makes that determination. So you don't have to be the expert. You don't have to have it figured out. You don't need to know for sure. But if you see something and you have a reason to suspect that there is something happening, would rather you bring that forward in terms of really being able to ensure the safety of a young person than to have it not be said and then to turn out that there actually was something going on and we may be too late.
Are we talking strictly physical abuse or are we talking neglect?
We are talking neglect in a comprehensive fashion. I mean, the majority of our reports are actually neglect and not abuse, so I'm glad you asked that distinction. Well over 75% of our reports are actually more under the heading of neglect. So that's in terms of, you know, whether or not there is sufficient food, clothing, shelter, you know, are the kids going to school in terms of parental guardianship, you know, is there appropriate supervision, you know, things along those lines. So that is really the majority of the reports that we get. You know, certainly we do have reports that meet the standard of abuse, whether you have serious physical abuse, if you have sexual abuse. But again, the majority of our reports are really neglect.
What are some of the signs or the symptoms that, you know, generally I would say, my God, if my gut told me something, but what should people, if they suspect, what should they be looking for? How may it manifest itself? And then you say, I got to make a call.
Right. And that can manifest itself in different ways because, as we are aware, kids, you know, express themselves in different ways. But, you know, certainly if someone has a mark that is mm-hmm. not in some place where you would typically, you know, kids play, they get, you know, they cause injuries. What if something is not where you would typically see a bruise, or if there is something about the way the bruise looks, or if there is some change in that child's demeanor or their behaviors. You know, if you have a child that's usually outgoing and talkative, you know, if you start to see them be more isolated and to be quiet, what's going on? What's, you know, what's causing that change in behaviors? If it's, you know, the summer and it's 90 degrees and the child is covered from head to toe mm-hmm. in a sweater, you know, so you look for things that just seem not quite the norm. That's what I would say. Usually if you see something that it's just, that's not how it usually is. Just, you know, looking for those signs, because oftentimes, you know, you won't find a child who's going to necessarily come in and say, this is going on. Mm-hmm. And so it's really being able to use the observation skills to kind of observe, you know, if you've seen something different.
Sure. I bring this up because I know on the national news, of course, obviously we've had very high profile cases with parents, some that have now been convicted and are going to jail for the rest of prison to the rest mm-hmm. for the rest of their lives, the treatment of their children all the way up to age 30. And yet you wonder how can this happen? How can someone not see and someone not say something?
Well, and I think it's just that. I don't think it's necessarily that someone did not see. I think it's more someone did not say, because, you know, oftentimes we want to give someone the benefit of the doubt, and we do. There is still absolutely parental rights in terms of, you know, the autonomy and the ability to raise their children the way that they seem fit, as long as it's not, you know, against any legal, you know, framework in regards to any criminal activities or anything that's going to cause harm. But there's still definitely a lot of leeway, if you will, given to parental rights. And so we see things, and sometimes we want to give someone the benefit of the doubt, like, who would really purposefully harm their children? And so I think within that framework and that space, we tend to say, yeah, I don't think, maybe that's not what it is, but, you know, it really is. When you see something that makes you stop and pause for a second and say, like you said, something in my gut is telling me that maybe there's something going on there, or again, you're seeing things, you're aware of this child and you know how they have been previously and you've noticed some significant change in their behaviors, their presentation, then, you know, again, you know, oftentimes, rather you say something, and it may anger the person. And again, when mm-hmm. you make a report, it's anonymous, you know, mm-hmm. so sources are anonymous. But sometimes people can figure out where a report came from.
Sure.
But, you know, if it's someone's anger versus the safety of a child, I would rather us are right. on the side of the safety of the child.
Right. How difficult is it? You know, you wonder when like I mentioned, the national case, when you're dealing with the children, how difficult is it afterwards, when the children have been living in these conditions and experiencing abuse, extreme abuse and neglect. How do you deal with that?
It is very difficult, and it's very long-term. We're talking about years and years of trauma often that has gone unaddressed. And so when there is finally that intervention, you know, certainly depending on the circumstances, the immediate interventions of, is it that we need to make sure that they have a safe roof over their head, clean clothes, sufficient food? There is that. Is there a need for immediate medical attention? So there is the immediate physical interventions, if you will, but then it's so long-term in terms of just addressing what is oftentimes going to result in the mental and social concerns in terms of, you know, how do you nurture this person back to, you know, some sense of normalcy? Because, you know, oftentimes that does become the norm. So then sure. How do you, you know, make that shift then to what really should be normalcy? And how do you help them then to manage those feelings in terms of, this is the person who gave me life, and really trying to manage the fact that this was also the person who mistreated me or did not care for me in the way that I should have been cared for. And those are very conflictual feelings. I think sometimes it's hard to understand why children are so conflicted in terms of, that person abused you. Why would you still want to love them? Why would you even want to still consider being with them or going back to them? But those are very real feelings sure. that, you know, abused children we have to help them manage and come to terms with as well.
Everyone wants to be loved. It's just a basic human
absolutely.
Nature,
right? Absolutely.
I know that the first course for placement is generally to see if there is family,
absolutely.
Appropriate family. But if there isn't, and you're dealing with a situation like this, where, you know, multiple siblings and years of neglect, that's got to take very, very special foster parents.
Yes, and so within our foster care services, if you will, there are different levels of care. So you have your, what we would call our basic foster care level. Then we have special, so where there is a more, based on the needs of the children, there is a more intense need of services and skills from the foster parent. And then we also have therapeutic. So, you know, depending on what the needs are of the youth, then, you know, there are different levels of care to help support that, because you're absolutely right. When you have someone who has experienced years and years of trauma and abuse, that manifests itself, can manifest sure. itself in many, many different ways. And so as you think about wanting to be able to support them as they try to heal from that and progress from that, then, you know, that entails making sure that wherever they then go to has the necessary skills, support, and resources to be able to nurture that.
And we have talked previously about there are very special training sessions mm-hmm. and a whole process for prospective foster parents that they go through. And I'm assuming with each level, as you mentioned, there is more intensive training.
Well, and certainly that is the goal. I think there's always a room to be able to improve upon that, but certainly anyone who is going to be a certified foster parent has to go through the MAP program. And then after that, there is an opportunity to get additional trainings, if you will, in regards to, you know, better understanding of mental health in children. You know, if there is the potential to take in a child that may have some medical needs, you know, maybe a child that may be on a sleep apnea machine or some sort of medical device, then being able to receive training in that as well.
So if someone is interested in going through that training, I'm assuming that they are, it's not offered all the time, there must be special times. Do they call or look at the website to find out?
Right. So we look to offer here at the department the MAP training 3 to 4 times a year. We also have our voluntaries that also do their own recruitment. So if someone may present themselves that is looking to be a foster parent and maybe we are not at that time offering the MAP classes, then we would certainly refer them to one of our voluntary agencies. At the end of the day, if someone is truly interested in being a foster parent, then that's the goal, and that's the common goal, is to be able to have enough resources to meet our needs. Unfortunately, over the past few years, we've seen a trend in the number of children coming into care. So, you know, the ability to have viable resources to be able to care for these children when they come into care is important. And I'm glad you mentioned a few minutes ago in regards to really looking at families. So there has definitely been an emphasis in terms of not just our traditional foster boarding homes, foster parents, but also in regards to really reaching out to relatives and what we call fictive kin. So it may not be someone that is related by blood, but they have had some significant relationship with that child. And so really trying to have that be the first avenue, if you will, and the first approach in terms of resources if a child has to come into care.
I've been talking with Gail Geohagen-Pratt, the commissioner for the Albany County Department for Children, Youth, and Families. Let's switch gears ever so slightly and talk about something that, as we are taping this program, mm-hmm. has been in the news recently, and I'm talking about the issue with Robert Kraft, the owner of the Patriots, mm-hmm. and an issue of alleged solicitation of a prostitute in Florida, which has brought up an allegation that there was human trafficking mm-hmm. involved at this spa. And that certainly has gotten our attention. Human trafficking mm-hmm. is something that Albany County has been trying to be at the forefront in terms of awareness and prevention. January, mm-hmm. I believe, was
Human Trafficking Awareness Month.
Mm-hmm. Albany County, as I said, very proactive with several programs, one of them the Safe Harbor Program. Mm-hmm. Talk to me about the Safe Harbor Program and the fact that you're probably hearing a little bit about more human trafficking lately. When it comes up in the news, that's when you hear more about this.
Absolutely. And so within Albany County, we've had the Safe Harbor Program for 4 years now. And at the core, the essence of the Safe Harbor Program is, again, about community education and awareness. So when oftentimes when folks hear about human trafficking, there's a tendency to think, oh, that's something that happens in other countries. That doesn't happen here in the United States. And so certainly within the past 4 years, with the education in regards to this, one of the pieces of information that we've been able to communicate is that it very much happens in the United States, and that New York State itself ranks fifth when it comes to human trafficking. So it's very much prevalent here in New York State. And so really it's about that education and awareness. Again, you know, looking around and observing, and if you're seeing something that seems to give pause to, you know, what you're seeing. And so, you know, we've talked about what may be some of the signs. So if you have a youth that, you know, does not have the type of employment that would then align with them having, you know, a lot of jewelry or a lot of, you know, smartphones or, you know, different, if they're seeming to have a lot of items that, you know, cost some money,
sure.
and they don't have the type of job that would support them, you know, readily having access to that, then what is going on? You know, not to stereotype, but, you know, if you see a young lady, you know, her nails are done, her hair is done, you know, in a lot of fashion, you know, how is she getting that? Who is supporting her? You know, where is that coming from? You know, unfortunately for our foster care youth, they're very susceptible and very much at high risk of being trafficked. So if you have a youth that is often going AWOL, why are they going AWOL, absent without leave? Why are they going? Where are they going? What is happening? So actually, with the Office of Children and Family Services, there was an ADM that was issued, I want to say, about 4 years ago, which is Preventing Trafficking and the Safe Families Act. And so incorporated into that is a sex trafficking screen that is administered on all CPS investigations. And if there is a child that is in care that goes AWOL, then there is a screen that needs to be administered upon their return, because again, we want to ensure that, you know, certainly the youth that we are coming in contact with and we have some kind of connection to are not being trafficked.
Hmm. when, you know, I think many people, when they think about it, like you said, human trafficking, it's other countries. Mm-hmm. But if they think about it being in the United States, they think, okay, it's, you know, the kids on the street, homeless kids on the street. Mm-hmm. It's very interesting that you say it could actually involve kids that are actually in the system.
It involves children in the system, and it does not discriminate. It cuts across all racial, socioeconomic, and oftentimes the traffickers are someone the children know. So again, when you think about, you know, child predators, when you think about your pedophiles, it's not often the boogeyman or the monster that we have in our mind, because you have to gain a level of trust. So it's the person that you may not suspect. You would not assume that that is happening, and oftentimes, unfortunately, those are the ones that are perpetrating. So, you know, it's a relative, it's a close family friend. Mm-hmm. So again, just being aware and observing, you know, what are the relationships that my child is forming? Who are these people? Are they spending alone time? What does that look like? You know, there's so many factors to just be aware of. I think, you know, that's definitely what I would underscore to anyone, is know where your children are, know what they're doing, know who they're coming in contact with, monitor their social media, just be informed.
Talk a little bit about, very briefly, the training available, I Am Little Red, because when you're talking about that, that right away triggered that I needed to bring that up.
Mm-hmm, absolutely. So again, it's really about understanding human trafficking, how it happens, and recognizing what the signs are in regards to being able to identify if there is someone who is potentially at risk of being trafficked.
So it is a video?
Yes, correct.
Video that's shown to?
We gear it towards students. So okay. We have reached out to local school districts and have had some success in regards to having it shown, whether it's through a health class. Usually it's through a health class as part of the curriculum, because a lot of schools do have health curriculums in regards to children being empowered and knowledgeable in terms of their well-being. And so for some of the schools who have been open to us, they see this as a natural part in terms of that curriculum.
Is there, I did not look at it, is there a target age group that this video is for the students?
It is geared towards a little bit of an older crowd, so I would say definitely for your middle school and high schoolers, maybe not your elementary schoolers.
Okay. And I'm sure it does trigger some questions.
Absolutely. And I think that is good. I think at all age, no matter how old a child is, there is an opportunity to have conversations. It just needs to be tailored to where they are developmentally. And so in terms of the questions that may come up, it's really being able to answer them as honestly as possible, because I think that's important, is to be able to have honest answers to when a young person is asking you a question, but also to present it in such a way that it is age appropriate and developmentally appropriate, so that they can access the information that you're trying to give.
In about 30 seconds or so, so we've seen the flags, we now know someone is, or highly suspect someone is a victim of human trafficking. Mm-hmm. What do you do? How do you get that person out? I gave you 30 seconds, which is tough.
Yes, that is tough. I mean, because oftentimes it is not easy to get someone out. There is definitely an element of where the person also wants to be out and how to be able to support them through that. So, you know, there's certainly a level of readiness. At the very least, in terms of helping, is being able to get them information in terms of, you know, what are the numbers that you can reach out to, in terms of if there's immediate need for, you know, food, clothing, you know, a phone, just to be able to make a call. Certainly, if someone is looking for the level of assistance where they're looking to no longer be trafficked, there's a call to local law enforcement. Okay. You know, if there's a need for medical attention, there's taking them to the hospital so they can get that. So there are various ways, but it's on an individual basis, if you will, in terms of assessing what exactly is happening with that person's circumstances and what help are they requesting at that point in time as well.
Okay, information certainly on our website, albanycounty.com, and folks can click on departments, Department for Children, Youth, and Families, and there's a whole list of all the programs and things we've talked about today.
Absolutely.
All right. Thank you, Gail.
No, thank you, Mary.
For joining me again. This is Gail Geohagen-Pratt, the Commissioner for the Albany County Department for Children, Youth, and Families. I'm Mary Rozak. This has been Albany County News. We'll see you again soon.